Energy policy and its direction are at a critical point. The EU and the UK are committed to significant reductions in emissions of carbon, and energy supply is expected to make the lion's share of such a reduction. Targets have been set relating to the amount of renewable energy there should be in the energy and, by implication, electricity mix. But are those targets achievable? How will we get there? And at what cost to consumers and business? I'm talking to David Odling, Oil and Gas UK's Energy Policy Manager, to find out more. So David, where does the UK energy come from currently?
Let's first draw a distinction between energy and electricity clear from the outset, as sometimes there is confusion between the two. Electricity is just one component of energy supply. The UK's demand is split between electricity, transport and heating, with each of them accounting for roughly one third. Now, oil and gas currently satisfy about three quarters of that overall demand for energy, and the rest comes from coal, from nuclear, and a modest amount from renewable sources. So if we just talk exclusively about electricity, the proportion of electricity accounted for by gas has risen from almost nothing in the very early 1990s up to 40% in 2009. And then on top of that, roughly speaking, coal contributes another 30%, nuclear 20%, and jointly renewables, including traditional hydropower and imports, make up the remaining 10% of electricity generation. Then in terms of the other two thirds of the energy, the vast bulk of heating comes from gas, and in no less than 80% of our homes. And then oil dominates transport. So those are roughly the proportions making up our energy supplies.
There are particular challenges associated with satisfying electricity demand in future, though, aren't there? Can you explain what these are?
Yes, there's a lot of old coal, oil and nuclear generating capacity to be replaced in the next 10 to 15 years, some one third of the total. At the same time as undertaking this considerable replacement capacity, the government has committed to deriving 15% of all our energy from renewable sources by 2020 under an EU agreement. And given the difficulties of applying renewable energy sources to transport and heating, the growth of this renewables will need to be achieved mainly in electricity generation. Consequently, the 5% of electricity currently sourced from renewables, which includes traditional hydropower, needs to grow sevenfold to some 35% by 2020. And due to the lengthy timescales involved in bringing on stream new nuclear, clean coal, and those renewable sources in sufficient quantities, there is likely to be a gap in electricity generation from the later years of this decade and into the first half of the 2020s. For technical and financial reasons, reaching for the renewables target potentially jeopardises all three of the government's overall goals: security of supply, affordability, and ironically, even the goal of reducing emissions. In pursuit of the renewables target, the government is overlooking, we think, the continued potential of gas in meeting our energy needs in a cost-efficient, technically feasible, and environmentally beneficial manner. The knock-on effect is that firms are not being encouraged to think about investing in gas-fired power generation in the long term, which is exactly what we will be required to fill the emerging electricity gap.
What exactly is the downside of pursuing the renewables target in such a short space of time?
There are several financial and practical risks in the government's current strategy, which requires a transformation of our energy system and fundamental change in how we use and produce energy. Unprecedented amounts of new capital have to be raised and spent with good effect by companies whose balance sheets are already well stretched. The required rate of investment is extraordinary by any standards. And so trying to go too far too quickly increases the pressure on resources and increases the risk to residential, commercial, and industrial consumers of much higher prices. Dramatic changes in consumers' behaviour are required through the adoption of new technologies and the more efficient use of energy. Focusing on the renewables target reduces security of supply. In other words, there's a greater risk of the lights going out through insufficient power generation than there ever is of gas interruptions through a shortage of gas. And ironically, pushing to meet the renewables target by 2020 might actually result in higher emissions in the medium term, as the role of fossil fuels with a higher carbon content than gas is likely to be greater than it needs to be.
So how will a greater role for gas help avoid these problems?
Gas has proven technology and proven reliability. It has the highest efficiency for generating power. Gas-fired power stations can be built in the shortest time, and they also cause the least difficulty in planning. And perhaps above all, the gas infrastructure already exists, except for some extra storage which will have to be built over the next few years and is already in the pipeline. As a result, apart from heavily subsidised wind, gas-fired generation is the only type of power plant being built at the moment. Gas has the lowest capital cost of all types, and according to a recent study done for the Department of Energy and Climate Change by the engineering consultants Mott MacDonald, gas is currently the most economic type of generation in overall terms. If we keep the investment flowing into the offshore sector, domestic reserves could still satisfy some 40% of demand in 2020. And that may be a surprise to some. Domestic production, of course, is supplemented by a very wide range of imports and by storage. Proven reserves of gas worldwide amount to some 60 years of annual consumption. And as we've seen with unconventional gas in the USA, overall gas resources are extremely large, and we only have to refer to the IEA's World Energy Outlook to confirm that. The industry has invested over £10 billion in building gas import capacity in this country, currently operational and so on, and the volumes there can exceed our annual demand. Gas has substantially lower carbon dioxide emissions than coal and oil per unit of electricity generation, some 50 to 55% less in the case of coal, where the coming closures of generating capacity are the largest. Interestingly, the expansion of gas-fired power in the 1990s allowed the UK to meet its Kyoto target of cutting greenhouse gas emissions by 12.5%. between 1990 and 2008. Now, on top of that, gas also emits much fewer oxides of nitrogen and sulfur than coal or oil, and that has a benefit on air quality.